Welcome to The Secrets of Success. By following the proven techniques of the guests who appear on this series, you'll learn that even successful people run into detours and failures, and how you can apply their success techniques to change your life.
You're now listening to the most unique show on radio, the show dedicated to making you a success. Ron Price says, leadership is about influence. Let's ask him why. Ron, thanks for being with us today.
Bill, it's great to be with you. Thanks for inviting me.
Now, Ron, you've written a book called Growing Influence, and you've written this in the format of a business fable. It looks like a novel when we started reading about, I think, the two main characters. I think it's Emily and David. Why the business fable format?
Well, actually, some of the themes in the book are things that I've spoken to groups about for several years. And one of my colleagues said, Ron, you need to get that in a book. So it was probably 4 years ago that I started thinking about this. And as I worked on what the outline of the book would look like, I just didn't feel like writing it as a nonfiction business how-to book was going to resonate with readers the way that I was hoping it would. So I asked who had been my writing assistant and executive editor if she would help me to write it as a fable. And she now tells me that she said yes with great trepidation. At the time, she didn't show me the trepidation. But it's a funny thing, the writing process. When she gave me permission to begin to approach it that way, all of a sudden, the ideas flowed. And by the first 4 days that we spent together working on the book, I pretty much had the whole story in my head. And we just needed to fill in the details. And I felt that the themes that we talk about, they had to be combined with emotion. And without a certain amount of emotion, they just weren't going to connect with readers the way that we were hoping.
Well, we thank you for taking on the extra effort. It would seem to be a lot easier for you just to put down the way a nonfiction presentation is. But you made it more interesting and gave us a few characters. Now, Emily and David go back and forth with their conversation. And David is kind of the wise, older man who I think they occasionally see each other in the local Starbucks or coffee house or whatever. And at one point, David says to her, are you happy? Do you feel like you're fulfilling what you're meant to do in life? That's a big question. In the real world, how does that usually get answered? How do you find people responding to that?
Well, it is a big question, Bill. And David was much like a lawyer, which I understand you have some experience with as well. A lawyer never asks a question without knowing the answer. He had been observing the way that she was running around, and he could tell that she probably wasn't feeling that she was right in the middle of the stream of her purpose in life. So he asked her that question. When we ask that question in real life, a lot of people that we ask it to, I'd say the vast majority of people that we ask it to, give us a sort of a puzzled look and pause, and then come back and say, yeah, probably not. And some of them will say, I'm successful. I've got a good company that I own, that I've built, it's profitable. But I haven't quite reached that place where I can say I'm really happy. There's always something that I'm still trying to fix or still trying to get worked out, that if I get there, then I'll be happy. And of course, we know that's a bit of a trap. If you are not happy today, what's really going to change tomorrow to make you happy? Because there's a big difference between happiness and success.
That's a real tough, big, open-ended question, because I could see at first, yeah, I'm happy. I have a car. I have a wonderful wife and family. But then when we start thinking about it the next day, or when we're taking a walk or a shower at the gym, am I really happy? And in the book, Emily admits that she often feels powerless at work. Do most of us feel this way? Is this something that if you really get beyond the surface of the way things look, do most of us admit to that?
I think it depends on the topic. And what's surprising to me, because a lot of my work is working with business owners or CEOs, is how often they feel powerless. And you would think certainly the person at the top has to feel like they've got power. But they often feel powerless to bring about the changes that they're looking for. And so, yeah, I think most people feel some degree of powerlessness. And a part of what David says to Emily early on is you probably have a lot of power that you don't recognize. And so he starts by talking to her about how she can get centered, or she can get focused on the things that she can control, that she can take 100% responsibility for, and let power grow from there.
Now, when they get talking a little bit, it breaks down. She says that, you know, essentially it comes to the point that she has no influence in the office. How would you define influence?
Yeah, so this is this comes back to what I think is the fundamental definition of leadership. First, Peter Drucker, who's a great writer who's passed away now, but a great thought leader around leadership, he used to define leadership as somebody with followers. And of course, that sounds a little bit comical, but you think about it, that is the common denominator. If there isn't anybody following, it's hard for you to consider yourself a leader.
Very true.
So I took that and I thought, so what is it that makes people want to follow? What is it that makes them want to say that somebody's their leader? And I concluded it's because in some way that person has become a person of influence in their life. And they can be a person of influence because of who they are, the way they present themselves, their character. They could be a person of influence because of what they know, what they're capable of doing. Or they might be a person of influence because of the title and the authority and the responsibility that they have. But really, when I think about how do you define influence, it's somebody who gets you to think, speak, or act differently because of something that they did. And sometimes people influence us because we say, I'm not going to be like her, or I'm not going to be like him. And other times they influence us because they represent something that we'd like to become ourselves as well.
So I'm thinking that as I'm talking to you on today's show, Ron Price is a person of influence because he's trying to get us to think, speak, and act somewhat differently and kind of wake up some nerves that may have been just dormant for a little while. Could we say that? Is that a fair description?
I think it's kind, and I think it's fair, Bill. I'm actually in my 49th year of being involved in leading people in a organizational sense. And what happens as you get older is you begin to become a little bit more philosophical. You look back on your career and you think about what worked and what didn't work. And one of the things that evolved for me is this idea that people have a lot more opportunity to influence. They have a lot more personal power than they realize. So part of what David's doing with Emily is helping her to discover and begin to exercise that power that she has.
Ron, before we continue asking you questions, we want to let our audience know if you're enjoying what you're hearing. We want you to know that you're listening to The Secrets of Success, the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC. I'm your host, Bill Aran, and today we're talking to our guest, Ron Price. He's the author, along with Stacy Ennis, of a book called Growing Influence. And Ron, would you tell us where we can get the book, and is there a website where we can find out more information?
Yes. First, you can get the book anywhere where books are sold. If they don't have it in stock, they can get it ordered for you. But we do know that most of the Barnes & Noble stores around the country have it. You can also get it on Amazon.com or BarnesandNoble.com. And it's available in print, in ebook, in all the ebook formats. And it's also available in Audible through Amazon.com. And if people would like to visit our website and get some more materials, including some videos that we have and things like that, they can go to price-associates.com/growing influence. So price-associates.com/growing influence.
And as we always tell our audience, we put out the buffet dinner, but you have to get out there and sample it and try some of these things if you really want to change your life, if you want to get into that world, if you don't feel you're successful, or if you'd like to find some more success. An excellent book brings out some ideas here and just says that question that Ron posed before. Are you happy? And if so, why so? And if not, maybe what's missing? Let's pinpoint those things and turn them around a little bit as we go through the show this evening. Now, Ron, you mentioned three types of influence. Can you tell us what those are and how they differ?
Yes. So the kind of influence that most of us recognize right away, we refer to as positional influence or positional leadership. And that's somebody who's been given responsibility and authority and usually some type of a title that goes along with it. And they influence from that position. I've been privileged to be the leader of several different companies now, and as a president or as a CEO, a lot of times people are following the position, not the person. But still, it's a position of influence because you have some power over budgets and over structure and strategy and the development of talent, all those things. So you've got influence through your position of authority and responsibility. The second kind of influence we refer to as expert leadership or expert influence. And this is where people are influenced by you because of what you know and what you're capable of doing. So it could be your tax accountant. We're getting close to having to turn in our tax returns for another year. It could be your dermatologist. It could be the head of marketing. It could be the head of accounting or whatever. It's somebody who influences you, and you actually think differently, talk differently, or act differently because of what they know, what they're able to do, and how they guide you and lead you. And then the third kind of influence that we write about in the book, we refer to as character influence or character leadership. And these are people that we follow because of who they are, because we want to be like them when we grow up, because they represent something that touches us at a deeper level. And they don't only get our commitment because of their position or their expertise, but they get our commitment because of who they are. And so in the book, we talk about how do you define that? How do you bring some detail to understanding what it means to grow your influence as a character leader? Bill, what we bring out in the book is that character influence and expert influence are your job. They're your opportunity. You get to decide where you go. In today's world, you have tremendous freedom to develop your character and develop your expertise. Positional influence is given to you by somebody else, and it's always on loan. You always have to give it back. But really, if you develop your character influence, your expert influence, then most of the time those positions are going to find you instead of you having to look and find them.
And just to repeat that, you said there are three types or three positions, positional, namely the boss, the CEO, how he or her leads you, the manager, whatever it might be, the principal if it's a school, the expert, when we have a problem, we go to an accountant if it's financial or a financial planner or a doctor or a pharmacist, etc. And a person's character, someone stands out and you know they will be honest with you, that natural leader, I guess, that we find in certain groups, and they're always the one who's picked as captain, or they would be the first one to be put in the group to be elected president of a club or something. So did I get that more or less correct?
You did get it right. That third one, character, yes, they may be chosen to be the captain, but I would say it's not charisma that you're born with. I would say that it's character that you build over your lifetime. And we in the book, we break it down into defining character by how you govern your own behaviors and then how you relate to others. And Emily goes through a process of deciding how she wants to do both of those things very practically, how she wants to govern her own behaviors and relate to other people. And David encourages her that you keep working on that throughout your lifetime. And the more you work on it, the more influence you have. So again, this is something that we control 100%. No matter where you're at today, no matter what kind of disappointments you've had in the past, you can create a different future by building your character influence and by building your expertise.
Now, I know you mentioned, and you led right into it there, there are things we can control 100%. What we have for lunch, pretty much, we can put in our lunch bag, or we can go out and buy the type of lunch, our character, things like that. And then you talk about collaboration. So where does that come in? How do we bring those parts into our growing influence?
Well, there's some things that we want to influence, but we recognize quickly that we don't have enough power on our own to do it. But if there are other people in our organization or in our community who have the same interest, they have the same desire to influence, we can work together. We can figure out a way to, in the book, we refer to this as building a virtuous conspiracy.
Oh, I remember that.
Yeah, we can figure out. And so in Emily's case, one of the things David asks her is about the culture at the technology company that she works at. And Emily points out that there's a lot of criticism and not much appreciation. And David said, well, are there other people who feel the same way as you? And Emily said, yeah, there are a lot of people I know who would like to see it be a more encouraging environment to work in. So he encourages her to think about how they could do something informally to begin to recognize people, maybe take them out to lunch once a month, or develop some way of living and demonstrating the kind of culture they want to see, and that over time they can begin to infect that negative culture with more positivity and eventually bring a change to it. And she does it. She does it with great success.
Ron, we're at that point in the show where we're going to take a brief break, but we want to remind our listeners that you're listening to The Secrets of Success on the Voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC. Today we're talking to Ron Price, our guest, and I'm your host, Bill Horan. We'll be right back after this brief intermission.
It only takes a minute to find out if you may have prediabetes, and you can do it at doihaveprediabetes.org. But you're probably not going to. Nope. I'm sure you've got a perfectly good excuse. Kids, work. I get it. You're busy. So what better time than now? Let's begin. Raise one finger if you're a man. Ladies, none yet. Oh, count in your head if you're driving. Now, three more fingers for everyone over 60, two over 50, one over 40, one more if you're not physically active, another finger if anyone in your family has type 2 diabetes. Another if you've got high blood pressure. If you're overweight, raise another finger. Two if you're very overweight. And three if you're really overweight. You've just taken the world's first audio prediabetes test. And if you're holding up five or more fingers, visit doihaveprediabetes.org or talk to your doctor. There's no excuse, because prediabetes can be reversed.
Brought to you by the Ad Council and its Prediabetes Awareness Partners.
Welcome back. You're listening to The Secrets of Success on the Voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC. I'm your host, Bill Horan, and today we're speaking with Ron Price, author of Growing Influence. Ron, it seems to me, just as a layman, we spend a lot of time talking about and arguing about things over which we have no control. I guess maybe like speculation, and maybe that's the basis of talk radio. But can you tell us how that fits into our growing influence in the business world?
Sure. One of the models that David shares with Emily is this idea that there are certain things we can control 100%. Some things we can get done if we collaborate with other people and build what we referred to before the break as a virtuous conspiracy. And there are always going to be some things that seem to be out of our reach to be able to influence. And they may, in fact, be out of our reach, or it may just be that our influence is invisible at this point. So we don't know this, but the big problem that we have is that oftentimes those bigger issues that seem like they're beyond our ability to influence steal a lot of our energy. They steal a lot of our focus. And if we keep focusing on them, it tends to take more and more and more of our energy. And in today's world, you can just look at the political scene, Bill, and see how much angst is being stirred up by what's happening in the world of politics and all the concerns that revolve around that. And if we spend too much time just observing and worrying, we're actually giving away our power. We're giving away our strength. So instead, what I advise leaders often, I was just actually working with 18 physicians today who are moving from being clinicians into also being leaders in a healthcare system. And a lot of what we were talking about today is when you're complaining, you're losing energy. When you're problem solving, when you're collaborating, you're gaining power, you're gaining energy. And if we focus on things that are outside of our reach, we're really taking away a lot of our power by focusing on what we can control and where we can collaborate together. There is really no telling how much influence we can build over time. And the people who do this year after year after year, they grow so that eventually their ability to control or to collaborate starts to invade that circle of concern. And they actually do begin to have influence in areas that they didn't have influence in before.
You know, I'm busy actually taking notes as you're talking, and two things I just wrote down to myself. Worrying gives away our strength. And I like that, because now I have an excuse not to worry.
Yeah,
I don't want to be giving away my strength. I'm not all that strong to begin with. And why would I want to give 20%, to use a visual aid, of my muscle or power away? And by collaboration, we gain energy. We always like a takeaway from the show, so I would say to our audience, think of those two. It's less than 10 words between the two of them. Worrying gives away your strength. Collaboration gains energy. So if you have a problem, don't worry about it. Just get together with some people, maybe an expert in the field, and work on it. Ron makes everything nice and easy. Ron, you mentioned to Emily in the book, and she's told to keep a journal. Now, what we hear that quite often. Why is that so helpful to people? Why should they do that?
Well, a big part of becoming the best version of ourself is knowing ourself and understanding what's happening inside our mind, what's happening with our emotions. And so the first part of it is that by Emily starting to keep a journal, she's saying, I'm going to take ownership of my own identity. I'm going to begin to take ownership of my own future by how I think of myself and how I develop myself. So this was really in the context of a challenge that David gave her, that until you as an individual decide to own some of your time and to spend that time on becoming a better version of you, you can never hope to gain the kind of power that's available to you. So she decided at first it was going to be 10 minutes or 15 minutes a day, and the way that she would own that time would be to journal. Not everybody is going to find it that way. When this happened to me back in the 1970s, I decided that I was going to spend 30 minutes a day reading books or listening to audio tapes that were going to challenge me about how I could become more effective in my job, how I could do a better job of managing my priorities, or how I could improve my relationships, things like that. So for some people, it's journaling. For some people, it's reading or listening to books. For some people, it may be meditating or something, but it's some way that you're saying, I'm going to take a part of my day and I'm going to own it, and I'm not going to let other things, other urgencies or worries get in the way of it. This is going to be the time that I'm investing in me.
I'm just doing quick math, and if we could get people even 15 minutes a day, that's almost 2 hours a week. And at the end of the year, that's an extra, I'm doing the quick math in my head, about 104 hours. How much we could learn, just fascinating new things, even if we only just want to talk about it at a cocktail gathering or meeting with friends, how interesting we would become. And if there's anybody there who listening who doesn't have 15 minutes a day, you must be very, very important. And I think I want to borrow money from you because you're probably very rich and can't spare the time. But you know what I'm saying? That's not asking too much. And if we could just write some thoughts down or get a good audio tape if we don't like to read, or pick up a book or take a little time out for ourselves, I'm sure we would gain a lot with that.
Yeah, and Bill, really, there are two keys to that being successful. And I think it's good that we linger there, because this is so, it's like the cornerstone of everything else that you do in becoming a person of influence. The first step is to make a clear commitment to yourself and not to be wishy-washy about it, but to set aside a time. Ideally, it's the same time every day. For me, it's early in the morning, because that's when I have the least chance of being interrupted by other folks. The second step is telling the people around you who may tend to interrupt you that this is my time. So one of the things Emily does in our story is that she goes to her boss and says, I just want you to know I'm coming in a half hour early each day so that I can work on developing me. And he immediately says, oh, that's great. We got a lot of things to do around here. That'd be great for you to be here an extra half hour. And she says, no, you don't understand. I'm not working for the company during that half hour. I'm working for me. And you have to make that commitment, and you have to communicate it clearly. Bill, later in my career, I actually got that time, and I know most people are going to think this is impossible, but I was running an international business with operations in 8 different countries, and I got to where I could own 4 hours every day to work on me and strategy and the things that really require deeper thinking, where I was not interrupted by anybody during that time. And it worked because I made the commitment to myself, and I announced it to all of my colleagues that that was my time. And I made space for them in other parts of the day so that they knew they had access to me another time.
Ron, I want to explore that a little more, but I just want our audience to know, if you're just tuning in and saying, what am I listening to? Who's this real smart guy who's talking? Well, you're listening to The Secrets of Success on the Voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHBC. The smart man who's talking is the author of the book, Growing Influence. His name is Ron Price, and I'm your host, Bill Horan. Ron, before we go further, would you tell our audience, is there a website where we can find out more about your book, Growing Influence?
Yes, thanks, Bill. Our listeners can go to price-associates.com/growing-influence. And they find out more about the book, and that website tells them we have a lot of things that are free on there that they can take advantage of.
And I've been taking a lot of notes throughout the show. If someone has missed part of the show or you'd like to hear it again when you can sit down or you have more time with a pencil and pad to take the notes, you can always listen to podcasts of the show by going to nccradio.org. Just go to podcasts and then the Secrets of Success. You don't need any code names or magic words or numbers to get in, and you can enjoy hearing what Ron said again. Then you can go to his website, maybe even take a read of his book and start getting a little more influence in your life. Ron, you said you were able to get 4 hours a day, and that hits on the next topic that I was going to bring into self-management. Is that kind of a dovetail that you finally learned how to manage your own time and was able to squeeze out those 4 hours a day?
Yeah, it all started there. And in that particular case, I'll tell you, Bill, that I'm in a new role here because we've had Price Associates, an executive coaching and innovation and culture firm, for the last 15 years. And it's a new role, and now I'm back down to 2 hours a day. But for most people, 2 hours a day is pretty amazing. And that sets the whole course of my day. During that time, I'm doing reading. I'm doing journaling. I'm looking at what my priorities are, what my goals are, what our purpose is, our core values. I'm looking at my definition of character for me. What are the values by which I choose to govern my own behavior? And what are the values by which I choose to relate to other people? I'm working on further developing my expertise. And I'm thinking about what the responsibilities are that I have as the CEO of our company. I'm doing all those things during the 2 hours, all things that I would say are important, but not urgent. And that sets my compass. It makes me much more effective. And I think you could say it makes me more powerful throughout the rest of the day.
And if you can find 4 hours, I challenge our listeners, and it's just a fun game we can play with ourselves, because again, this is for your own growth, success, happiness. How much time could you find during the day? And you don't have to read for an hour. Maybe you take a walk for half an hour. Maybe it's thinking time. But give yourself, if Ron could find, and he sounds like a very, very busy man. He also wrote this book. He's always doing something. He's leading seminars and businesses. I'm sure most of us could find a few minutes of self-improvement. Ron, as we talk about your book, Growing Influence, how do you want our listeners, or what do you want them to take away from the show today and from what they've heard from you, aside from going out? I'm sure you want them to buy the book, but what message do you want our listeners to get?
Well, probably the number one message is that we have untapped power. We have untapped resources inside ourselves, and it's not that difficult to tap into it. It takes a few simple habits that you can begin to grow, and it's not something where you become Superman overnight, but you grow day by day and week by week. You get a little bit better over time, and no matter how many bad situations we face, no matter how many times we're victimized, we don't have to own the label victim. We can be proactive, we can take initiative, and we can create a better tomorrow. No matter what the past is, we can start today creating a better tomorrow one day at a time.
Ron, I love that, and it's funny, I was just writing that quote out for a talk I'm giving, that success is a bunch of little habits done on a regular basis. We want to thank you for being with us today and remind our audience that if you like what you've been hearing, you're listening to Ron Price. He's the author of Growing Influence. Real quick, the website, Ron?
Once more, it's price-associates.com.
Ron, thanks so much.
Growing Influence. So, Bill, thanks. It's really been great to be with you.
Thank you so much for being with us. We'd like our audience to know that you've been listening to The Secrets of Success on the Voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHBC. I'm your host, Bill Horan, asking you to please join us again next week at the same time when we will continue our journey to success.